Hello.
Hello.
And thank you all for coming today. My name is Art Bergeron, and I'm delighted to be back at the campground. It's another beautiful day. Why are they always beautiful here? I am here today because I had talked to your folks at the program committee about doing something that would be of interest really to a kind of a growing piece of the population here. And thank you very much to Gretchen for inviting me. You and Hazel Allen were very kind, right? So what we wanted to talk about was, well, as you know, my name is Arthur, as some of you know, my name is Arthur Bergeron. I do elder law. I'm in a firm called Myrick O'Connell. There are 60 of us. I'm the elder law person. This is all that I do. Is that better? Is that better? Should I be holding on? No, this is good. Okay. And what I have done here in the past is I've done presentations specifically focused around elder law issues that might be of relevance to you. But when I talked to Gretchen, we talked about the fact that there is a particular issue that I think everybody here should really be aware of. It relates to my clients. And by the way, you can't see this real well, so you need to be following along on your program. I am told by thank you very much, Tom, who is doing the videography today, that he's going to insert these slides because this is going to be shown on local cable also, because it really is relevant to a lot of folks. We've talked before about my friends Frank and Mary and their kids Peter, Paul, and Mary Jr. And they are you know, they've got kind of average assets, and they own a home, and they got three kids, and their goal is to live in their house until they die and be buried in the backyard, and then eventually to distribute whatever they have left to their kids. Does that all sound familiar? This is not an unusual situation. But the issue that we want to talk about now is, oh, and by the way, that what's interesting about them is that they have a cottage. And for whoever owns actually this cottage, I'm sorry that I'm pretending this is Frank and Mary's cottage right now. So they own a cottage here, and they're coming here regularly. And one of the issues, though, that they are trying to face, and it is becoming not uncommon, is what happens if either Frank or Mary starts developing dementia. And you start thinking about, wow, we've been coming here for years and we love it here, but, you know, is it really safe here? Is it, you know, how can I know that there are programs here that will really be of interest to my folks, to my spouse? How do we make sure that this is going to remain a great place to come for as long as you live, so that you really can die and be buried in the backyard, and during that whole time you can always come to the campground? So I've got a set of people that I brought here to talk about the programs that are here now, and I also want this to be kind of the beginning, as I've talked to Gretchen and Hazel about, they said they're really interested in this, the beginning of a dialogue with the folks at the campground regarding how we can be developing programs that will expand during the summer, because a lot of these programs have been designed for the full-time population, expand during the summer so that you folks coming to the island will know that these programs are in place. So I'm starting with Rose Corleano, who was kind enough to come because she runs the Council on Aging, the Senior Center, a walking distance from here. She says she regularly has folks from here over there. She's got a program going right now, so that's why she's on first, to talk a little bit about the programs that are now available there and that folks, some of the folks here may not be aware of. Rose.
Arthur, thank you.
I'm told you're speaking into there, and I'll take care of your spot.
This is a thrill for me to be here. I haven't been here since 2007 when my daughter graduated from high school and actually stood up here and spoke. So it's just
so
magnificent.
So near and yet so far.
Precisely. But my name is Rose Corleano. I am the administrator of the Oak Bluffs Council on Aging. I want to thank you sincerely for this opportunity to speak with you and meet you. The definition of refuge in the American Heritage Dictionary is a place providing protection, a shelter, a haven, something to which one may turn to for help, relief, or escape. In our town, the town of Oak Bluffs, the Council on Aging is the refuge for many seniors and their families. As illustrated by our newsletter, we offer a myriad of various services and programs. Our full-time outreach coordinator, Gretchen Mayer, is available for home visits, health questions, and support. We have blood pressure clinics, exercise clinics, cards, mahjong programs, even a program about domestic animals, animal companions. At any time during the day between 8:30 a.m. and 3:45 p.m. Monday through Friday, people stop in for refreshments, conversation, and fellowship, all free of charge.
Can you quote that price again one more time?
Free of charge, nothing. Your tax dollars support this facility and keep our facility open. The Oak Bluffs Council on Aging has been and is the first step for assistance and recreation for seniors. We want you to visit us and we welcome you. And I want to thank you again for your kindness and time in inviting me here. If you have any questions, please don't hesitate to call us. Our number is 508-693-4509. We would love to see you. And thank you so much.
Rose, thank you very much. That was wonderful. Wonderful, Michael. Thank you very much, Rose. She's really close, right? But she hasn't come here very often, so you have to go there to see her. And she mentioned to me that there are a number of folks from here that use those services, and they're really, really important services, right? And I think that's a piece of the services that can really be growing in the future as we try to deal with all of us as we are all getting older. Leslie Clapp from the Center for Living has been the executive director there for many years and has developed during that time what has become a really substantial cluster of programs. But the base program has been a program that through which folks can come to two of the senior centers here, traditionally, the one in Vineyard Haven and the one in Edgartown. Even if they have early dementia issues, they can come and participate in programs. So I wanted to ask Leslie to talk about what those programs have been and are, and her hopes for where those programs could be going. Because I think this is going to really become, as the island ages, both the summer and the full-time population, an anchor of the kinds of programs we're going to need here. Leslie?
Thank you, Arthur. As he said, I'm Leslie Clapp, director of Martha's Vineyard Center for Living, and thank you also for inviting us all here. We have a lot to offer, all of us, and we all work together. It's all behind the scenes, and a lot of people don't realize the sort of complex network of services that are available here on the Vineyard to year-round residents and summer residents, and that we all work together. So each town has a Council on Aging. You're going to hear from Victoria Hazelbarth, who is from the Edgartown Council on Aging. But my point is that we work together, and we are... we've been doing this for years, and so we're a very sort of cohesive group, and we can develop programs that in one place that will serve everybody's needs. So as Arthur mentioned, the Center for Living, we've been around for a long time, but we're a nonprofit. Karen Achille is in the audience here. She's the president of our board. And so we have an array of services, and the whole premise behind this nonprofit is to work with all the communities, all the councils on aging, to provide programs and services that are island-wide. So they don't have to be specific. If you're a town resident, you know, of Oak Bluffs, you can come to our programs. You can participate in our programs. Our programs are island-wide. So. I'll just briefly mention the other programs that Arthur didn't mention. We have a medical taxi program that provides transportation to folks from Woods Hole to their doctor's appointments on Cape Cod. And it's done very simply. You call me. I'm going to leave a bunch of brochures, so if you want to pick one up, there's information in there and phone numbers. But I can help people get to their doctor's appointments on the Cape. And that's a 24/7, 7 day a week service. The emergency food program, which is all the councils on aging participate in. I coordinate the distribution of food that comes from Boston. So folks who are low income or in need of food assistance can, through our emergency food program, and as we collaborate with all the councils on aging, can get food if they need food. If you've ever read the Martha's Vineyard Times, which you probably have, once a month there's a small four-page section called the 55 Plus Times, and that provides information and referral for all kinds of activities that are going on all over the island. I coordinate that as well. So the information comes in to me, I sort of put it all together and put it in a format that the newspaper likes, and I send it on to them and they publish it. So it all works very nicely. So on to the Supportive Day program. This is a program that has been operating for 30 years, and the Center for Living currently is responsible for oversight and operating that program. It's a social model day care type program for elders who are at risk if left alone. They can't be left alone for whatever reason. It could be physical, it could be mental or cognitive, but it's a four-day program. 2 days a week we're in the Edgartown Senior Center. There's your collaboration with the Councils on Aging again. And 2 days a week we're at the Tisbury Senior Center. And we have programs designed from 9 to 3 that provide an opportunity to be to have social interaction, enjoy activities, play games, enjoy music. We have a lot of music programs. And lunch, so it's an opportunity for caregivers, family members, who are really 24/7 and are responsible to have a break. So not only is it a win for the folks who come and participate, who are otherwise home, alone, with really no opportunity to do anything or to participate in the activities at the Councils on Aging, because they can't really do that alone. So it's a win for them, and it's a win for the caregivers and the families. It's, as I said, a four-day program. We also work closely with Elder Services. There is a fee for the program, but through Elder Services of Cape Cod and the Islands, that fee is very often covered or supplemented by Elder Services. So otherwise, the private pay cost for a full day of participation, including lunch and transportation, is $40. And a half day fee is $30. And that also includes lunch. So it's very affordable. And for those who can't afford it, there are options. So it's a growing program. I don't know if you've been aware in the recent town meeting cycle, the county, with the town's blessing, has been asked to purchase a building in Vineyard Haven so that we'll be able to move our program into one location and be able to expand. Off and on, we have a waiting list, and we would like to be able to accommodate anybody who needs our services and be able to benefit from that. So, as I said, I'm going to leave brochures. Please take one. And I'll leave my cards as well. But thank you again. And if you have any questions, I'd be happy to answer them.
Thank you, Leslie. So as Leslie mentioned, what has been happening, what happened just this spring, is that all of the towns together have agreed to basically fund the development of one large permanent site for just this kind of program. I know that one of the things that they've been talking about has been trying to, with the necessary funding, expand it from a 4 to a 5 day program. One of the things that I'm interested myself in is in for folks who are in Massachusetts year round, but are coming here to visit, whether any of the benefits that they may be getting right now, if they have early stage dementia, if they're doing any of these things, could actually be transferred to here so that the Commonwealth would be paying while you're here. I don't know for you aliens who are coming for out of state whether we'll be able to pull that off, you know. But I think we're gonna try working on that. So Victoria Hazelbarth, her main and day job is at the Edgartown Council on Aging. I asked her to come to talk a little bit about that, and specifically to talk about the Memory Cafe, the work that is being done at Featherstone. How many here have been to Featherstone? Great. So you should hear about one of their programs, which runs out of Featherstone, which you know is this wonderful place, and to talk about, once again, what they think is coming in the future, where she thinks all of this is going. Victoria?
It's wonderful to be here today with all of you. My name is Victoria Hazelbarth, and I'm the outreach worker at the Edgartown Council on Aging. And one of my functions is to unite individuals over the age of 55 with services that are available to them on the island that might enhance their lives. And it's become, especially lately, a very, very busy job, busy undertaking, because more and more baby boomers are retiring here, and the population has escalated tremendously of seniors in the past several years. Today I'm going to speak with you about three things, some of the things that we do at the Edgartown Council on Aging, some of the things that are offered to you should you have concerns about your memory or the memory of a loved one, and thirdly, the greenhouse model in senior care, so which is hopefully in the next few years coming to a neighborhood near you.
And maybe to Edgar, and maybe to Martha's Vineyard.
To Martha's Vineyard, yes, that's true, because many of you, I realize, are seasonal residents. There are two other greenhouse models in Massachusetts, so we can't guarantee they're in your neighborhood, but they're certainly going to be here. We're working hard to fulfill that. Behind me, you'll see a slide of the beautiful Edgartown Council on Aging, which is located on Dock Street in Edgartown. We have a lot of activities going on there. As I mentioned, I perform the outreach function, but we have a wonderful director of senior services. Her name is Wendy Benedetto. And Wendy designs our programs and comes up with our monthly newsletter, which all of you will have momentarily, and our calendar. Some of the things that she brings to us is great music. Oops, wrong way. Try again. And here we have pictured Jeremy Berlin and Eric Johnson, and also the Martha's Vineyard ukulele group performing in our great room. And our great room is very special. It has tall windows overlooking the Edgartown Harbor, and we're trying to increase our programming there, providing lots of music. So far in the past year, we've had Jemima James, Dan Waters, the Long Point Five, and many others. We also offer a variety of exercise classes. In the upper left, you'll see two people participating in our stretching class. We also offer yoga, tai chi, strength training, and Pilates. You see in the bottom of the photograph our new intergenerational programming. Lately, we've been working collaboratively with the high school, hosting their honors program and hosting their sociology students, helping them meet with and dialogue with our seniors. We also work collaboratively with the Edgartown School. Currently, we have a host of eighth graders who are going out and doing friendly visits in the community and delivering meals to the homebound. So we have a wonderful, wonderful set of programming going on, especially through our collaborations. Here you'll see the Mindful Knitters, Knitting for Hospice, Needlepoint and Rug Hooking, which are some of the crafts that we offer. After lunch, games have become very popular, including Mahjong, Bridge, and Scrabble. And of course, many other programs. Please feel free to look at your calendars, which is an insert in the newsletter which you'll be receiving. We're very fortunate to have home-cooked meals prepared by our chef, Diane Wall. In the photograph, you'll see our receptionist right next to her. So we have a lunch program that operates on Tuesdays and Fridays, and it's the best deal in town. It costs $2 to attend lunch on Tuesday. The first time is free to entice all of you to come on down. And Friday it costs $5, Friday's meal is a little more elaborate, typically lasagna or chicken marbella with a super salad and maybe cheesecake with strawberries for dessert. It's all very good, I promise you, with an unsurpassed view. In addition to working at the Council on Aging, I'm also involved with the Healthy Aging Task Force, and that's an adjunct of the Dukes County Health Council. One of the things that we're trying to do is to make the Vineyard a more senior-friendly place by tackling all sorts of issues relevant to our services here and to make the Vineyard more hospitable to all of you, to encourage people to want to retire here and to be here for the rest of their lives. My favorite things that the task force is trying to bring, and I mentioned it earlier, is the greenhouse model in senior living and care. We have something to be very concerned about. Our population over the age of 60 has doubled in the past 15 years. And that's a trend that's going to keep on going. And the question arises, where are people going to live should they need some margin of care? Of course, everyone wants to remain in their homes. Nobody wants to go to an institution. People want to be close to their families, and people want to be in the place that they love and they enjoy. And that's where the greenhouse model comes in. The greenhouse is a residential equivalent of a nursing home. It houses between 10 and 12 residents in a warm, home-like setting. Everyone has a private room and bath. There isn't the administrative hierarchy that's typically found in conventional nursing homes. The resident is the star of the show, and the facility is governed by a self-managed care team. So a lot of the overhead can be cut, making this an ideal model for Medicaid patients as well as private pay patients. And as a result of all of the TLC a resident receives, they get home-cooked meals tailored to their dietary preferences. They can get up whenever they want in the morning and retire whenever they want in the evening. They design their own day, unlike in a conventional nursing home setting. Because of all of that, the greenhouse promotes very, very good health to an advanced age, and it's an evidence-based model. So stay tuned. Hopefully we'll have one here in the coming years. Lastly, I want to touch upon a very, very important subject, and that's memory loss as we age. Almost everyone will experience some form of memory loss. They say if you live to be the age of 90, 90% of us will have memory loss. And I'm in my 50s now. When I was in my 20s or 30s, I wouldn't need to rely upon notes, but now they're glued to me because of those occasional slippage. So, and if age-related memory loss weren't enough, we're all going to be faced with the scourge of Alzheimer's disease. It's on the upswing. It's estimated to, anticipated to hit about 40% of the population in the coming decade or so. So that's something that, as a community, we should all be very concerned about. If you are concerned about your memories, or you're concerned about the memories of loved ones, fortunately, the island is a wonderful resource. We have two wonderful programs that have just started in the past couple of years that can serve anyone with memory-related concerns. They are the Memory Support Group, which meets every Wednesday at Featherstone Center for the Arts. And secondly, the Memory Cafe, which is a more informal meeting every Thursday from 10 to 12 at Hillside Village 1. And you'll be receiving, if you haven't already, a handout about both the Memory Loss Support Group and the Memory Cafe. I'm one of the co-leaders of the Memory Support Group. Nancy Langman is the other leader, and she is the one who grant funded this, She got her doctorate in memory loss, and she's one of the go-to people on the island who has a reservoir of knowledge about the topic. On your handout, you'll see her number, Leslie Clapp's number, and my number. The group that meets every Wednesday at Featherstone is more of a formal, structured group. We introduce art and music each once a month because art and music are crucial to the formation and the retention of memories. The other 2 weeks of the month, we try to stay on an informational topic which helps us be safer in our homes and helps to stave off the progression of memory loss. So even if you don't have a formal diagnosis or someone who's just concerned about getting older and developing memory-related issues, please stop on by. We would love to have you. We would love to give you information and offer you support moving forward. The Thursday Cafe is a more informal setting, and I'm way behind on my slides. I should have let Arthur do this.
No, you're doing great, Victoria.
This is, I'm going to backtrack just a second. This is an example of the greenhouse model in Westwood, Massachusetts. This is an interior shot of the greenhouse model in Chelsea, Massachusetts. And here we have a photograph of Featherstone and our memory flyer, so I think we're pretty much caught up. So the Memory Cafe is a group that meets every Thursday. The Memory Support meets Wednesday at Featherstone, the Cafe Thursday at Hillside Village 1. I know it might be a little hard for you to hear with the bells going off, but
no, we did this on purpose because
okay.
This is going to be on cable, and we wanted to be able to prove to everybody that we really were in the tabernacle.
There you
right?
go.
And now everyone's going to know, right?
And also, one of the things that you may notice with memory loss is distractibility. So as my ear was registering those chimes, I developed a concern for myself trying to stay on track and listen to the music at the same time. Which it's important to note, music and art are the two basic therapies used to treat memory loss. They help restore old memories, they help keep us in a positive frame of mind that make us want to move forward when we're experiencing difficulties in our lives. And they're a major component of both the Memory Cafe. We have Anne Ducharme from the Martha's Vineyard Museum come once a month and go through beautiful pieces of artwork with us. And then we have the experience of actually creating art at the Memory Support Group on Wednesday. So there's a lot out there for all of you, and hopefully we'll see you at one of these wonderful events. Thank you for having me.
Thank you so much. So I'm sure you're getting a sense already that one of the interesting things about the island is that this is truly a set of six communities that are kind of thinking of themselves as one place. They've got their individual programs happening every place, but things are really pretty coordinated here, which is a wonderful change, I think, for a lot of us from where we're from, where every community is, you know, doesn't talk to the next community over. Finally, I've asked Sandy Cordolby to be here for a while to talk a little bit about, if you've got somebody who's coming onto the island who's got memory or other kinds of medical issues, how do you find the services here that you may have left behind at home when you came here? Sandy is the only geriatric care manager in her company, the only geriatric care manager here on the island. And I think for a lot of folks who are in this situation, and I deal with clients, these are my clients. I always say to the folks, my clients are people who are worried about Alzheimer's or people who have Alzheimer's or people whose friends have Alzheimer's. That's the issue, right? So for a lot of people who I know have developed programming and supportive services and oftentimes home care when they're at home, but you're saying to yourself, but boy, I'm coming to Martha's Vineyard, now what am I gonna do? I mean, am I gonna bring somebody from home? I don't think so, you know, maybe. But what can I do here? So I wanted Sandy to be talking to you a little bit about how to think that out. What the programs are that are here, what the issues are regarding home care here, and also where that's going. Sandy? I love the chime. I really do.
I'm not gonna
okay.
Thank you. I think that, you know, I just would like to say that I've never needed a microphone in my life. So you may need to. Sometimes I yell too loud for our camera guys. And I can't tell you how absolutely thrilled I am to be here with this panel of folks. Because whether you're visiting the vineyard, you're here seasonally, or you're here year-round, you probably know of the work that they do. And it is amazing to be included in such a group where the passion really is completely set on finding as many programs to improve and enhance the quality of all of our residents, but for the panel here, for the elders in our community. And I learn so much from all of them every day. A geriatric, I'm Sandy Cordolby, I'm a registered nurse. I'm certified as a geriatric case manager. I am, Arthur loves to say this, and my business partner, whom you don't really want to tick off because she was the police chief here for a really long time, is Beth Toomey. So I am not the only one. I own this business with Beth, who is circling out there trying to find a place to park. But together we own a company called Horizons Geriatric Care Management. Beth has her master's in behavioral health and is a counselor. And as I said, I'm a registered nurse and my background is 20 years of helping elders. So geriatric case management is actually the sort of funnel or the net that tries to find all of the programs that these great people run and direct the elders that seek out our services to the programs that will make them the happiest, that will enhance their life or fix a problem. We're problem fixers. I wanna also say, not to talk myself out of a piece of business here, but I also wanna say that these great ladies do the same thing. You know, you can go to the Councils on Aging and they will also direct you to lots of programs, not just their own. Again, they're a selfless group of people that are really just about doing the right thing. You can seek out the help of a geriatric case manager, and again, that is what our job is to make sure that we know about all of the programs, not only in our community, but also federally, that will help enhance the quality of your life or fix a problem or steer you in a direction that you may need to go for the future. The most phone calls I get right now, besides the hospital, which is definitely at the top of the list, and Victoria, are from elders that are saying to me, Sandy, I'm 90 years old. I didn't think I'd live this long. I'm afraid I might run out of money. What do I do? How do I get the care that I need? Or my mom is 90 years old, and she and my dad have run their finances all their lives. I don't know what they've got, but I need to know that they're going to be okay as they go forward. And those are the kinds of things that we help people figure out. The island is very unique. Geriatric case management is more about long-range planning. We do a lot of work with Arthur's group, actually, and many elder law attorneys. I'm sorry, there are a few more. We do a lot of work with helping people with their healthcare proxies, with their powers of attorney, and getting their estates set up to take care of them into the future. Because the island, the uniqueness of the island, and the shortage that we have here of caregivers in the home, Beth and I spend a lot of time doing that as well. We spend lots and lots of time finding somebody, whether it's just to come in for an hour and help get breakfast on the table, or go do some grocery shopping for some folks that don't drive anymore, or whether it's 24/7 care. We spend a lot of time, unique to our area as geriatric care managers, arranging some level of care for folks that need it. Sometimes it's just somebody to drive you around to do your own errands. Lots of times we get a phone call from a daughter or even the spouse of someone that says, my husband now has Parkinson's and I need a geriatric case manager to come out and tell me how am I going to need to change my house over the coming months or years in order to make it safe for him so that he can stay home. What are the things I'm going to need to know? So geriatric care managers also do a lot of comprehensive assessments to assess the physical and the emotional needs that are coming at you. That also falls into that whole home safety evaluation. We coordinate lots of doctor's appointments for folks because as we all live here on the vineyard, we know that some of our doctors are off the island. And we have to coordinate all of those. And if you go up to Mass General or you go to the Cape, does your primary care physician know what that specialist is ordering for medications? And they really need to know. And as a nurse, we can sort of, I can look at a med list and say, you know, I know that your doctor up in Boston wants you to take this, but you're already taking this, and those two aren't going to dance very well together, so let's call the doc and find out what to do about that. So we do a lot of medical oversight. There's a lot of elders or family members that hire us just to make sure that the medications are laid out correctly for the week so that the elder can take them. They may not know what all those bottles are, but if we put them in a pill planner, they can take them correctly themselves. What an interesting statistic is that in the United States, anybody over the age of 70 is on an average of 14 prescribed medications. 14. That's a lot to keep straight, and those are prescribed medications. And you know, I tell people all the time, stay away from us that are in the medical world because we're going to give you a bunch of pills to take, probably to fix a problem, but unfortunately then we're going to have to give you a whole bunch more to undo the problems that those are going to cause you, right? That's exactly what happens. We do a lot of mental health counseling, not only with our elders, but with their families. We have a very interesting family that we're working with right now, and it's two grown children, a daughter and a son, and dad died very suddenly in April. As we, you know, we're not trying to joke about it, but as we say, he just kind of woke up dead. In the morning, he was gone. He died very peacefully in his sleep, but that left mom without a caregiver, because little did the adult children know, mom had a level of dementia that dad was taking care of without bothering them with all those details. So now mom is there, and the adult children are figuring out mom really can't be left alone. Dad was doing a whole lot of work that they didn't know about, and they need care, and they need it quick, and they're grieving. So they're trying to figure out, I've really essentially just lost both of my parents, and I didn't expect to lose either one of them. So we do a lot of work with families that are in crisis. We facilitate a lot of work with elder law attorneys and most of it with Arthur. Very many times somebody has their spouse, and in the case of this woman, her husband, who has now died, is her healthcare proxy. Uh-oh, that's not gonna work. Or he's their power of attorney. That's not gonna work. The other thing that Arthur and I do a bit of that I like to talk about is we kind of run around the country, or mostly in Massachusetts, teaching people about MOLST. Does anybody know what MOLST is? No? MOLST is the medical orders for end-of-life care. It used to be that as an elder, you could go and have your doctor write DNR, do not resuscitate. If you don't want us pumping on your chest or sticking tubes down your throat to breathe for you in your elder years, you can say to your doctor at your next visit, I don't want that, don't do that to me. I'm 90, I've had a great life. If that's what happens, let nature take its course. Now, we have something called MOLST, which is much more detailed. It asks much more detailed questions. Do you even want to go to the hospital, or do you want to stay home? Do you want some IV therapy? Do you want some IV hydration? If we thought that we needed to breathe for you for a few days because you just have a really bad pneumonia, is that okay? The MOLST form gets into what I think is much more appropriate detail of the decisions that elders need to be making, or the healthcare proxies of someone need to be making in order to make the right decisions for that person individually. And the question then becomes, if you're an elderly couple, should your spouse be your healthcare proxy? Is that fair? Is that something that your spouse is going to be able to do for you in the middle of a crisis? I'm also a hospice nurse. I work for Hope Health. So we deal with this a whole lot. And I will tell you that maybe not. Maybe your spouse, who is also in their mid-80s, shouldn't be the person as you're in a, let's face it, a crisis situation and about to die. Maybe they're not the ones that want to be making that decision. Maybe you've got a daughter. Maybe you've got a son or a family member or even a close friend. But we talk a lot about those things as geriatric case managers, because an awful lot of times the spouse ends up being the healthcare proxy because they feel a level of obligation, when in actuality they don't really want to do it. And they're not going to be able to make the decision to turn off that machine. So my question is, should we have put you on the machine to begin with? I won't go into that any further than that. That's a whole different topic, but that's something that Arthur and I are very passionate about, making sure that people's wishes are well known, and geriatric care managers do a lot of that. We do a lot of education for folks into the alternative, I'm having word finding problems, Victoria, into different places for folks to live. I've got a lady over in Windermere right now, and it looks like going home is probably not her best choice. So where else can she go on Martha's Vineyard? I mean, she's at the hospital. Where else can she go on Martha's Vineyard? We know there's Windermere. It's hard to get in there. It's not just an automatic, if you live on Martha's Vineyard, that Windermere's gonna have a bed for you. And there's a couple of other long-term care assisted livings on the island, or do you need congregate housing, or do you need to go home with full-time care? We spend a lot of time trying to help people do that. And, you know, one of the jokes that we make, and I am so over my head with this with a couple of cases right now, is there's always an out-of-town daughter. There's always an out-of-town daughter. And what that means is that everybody's going along and the most has been filled out and decisions have been made and everything's going okay, but somebody forgot to tell the daughter that's in Kansas, and she is not okay with this. So we work a lot to help all the family members. We have one family that we're taking care of now where there are 10 children. And very different personalities, and what mom and dad want is okay with maybe about half of them. And the other half need a lot of help to get back on that page. So as geriatric case managers, we do a lot of that, is trying to help everybody sort of understand this really is about what mom and dad want. That's kind of the nuts and bolts of it all. Thank geriatric you. Case management. So give us a call if we can help. I think Brenda handed out some brochures. I'll be around. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. So, the point of all this, first of all, for those who may have a specific question, because you actually came to Martha's Vineyard this summer kind of taking a chance but figuring, you know, I don't know if this is going to work out. A lot of these folks are available afterwards to talk to you individually, and for other people who are watching on cable, that was one of the purposes of this program, is so that the folks who are here could get a sense of that. Second, there are just some remarkable people who are here on this island. And this island, I think, I do a lot of this work in a lot of parts of Massachusetts. I don't travel beyond Massachusetts. But compared to any place else in Massachusetts, this place gets it the best in terms of having a sense of a whole set of different services that are being coordinated to help people deal with this. I think that from the campground's perspective, from your perspective as a group, I can tell you now, I've been coming onto the island. I'm a kind of a quasi-Washashore now, because I've been coming for about 10 years. There's this sense that, you know, there's the island, and there's 17,000 of them, and they stay. And then there's you. There's a bunch of other groups that kind of blow in, you know? And they come in and say, oh God, the traffic, when are these people? Except they appreciate that you're here, you know, but you kind of come and you go. And then they're staying. And then from your perspective, of course, you know, there's Ohio and Indiana and Pennsylvania and the North Shore, and then there's here, right? And you come here and you're just kind of letting everything else go, and you're kind of coming here, and yeah, and you're going to Featherstone and doing some other stuff, and then you're going home. For you to be having folks or relatives who want to be aging here and continuing to come here, you need to be, and they need to be, really talking. From their perspective, it makes a lot of sense, both in terms of their being able to offer appropriate programs, and by the way, as an economic development matter. It makes a lot of sense for Martha's Vineyard as an island to be a place that you want to keep coming to and have the ability to keep coming to, even if somebody's a little sick or is going to, you know, kind of losing their memory a little bit, you know. So they have a real, I think that you folks have a stake too. So I hope that this is really kind of the beginning of a dialogue between those two groups. And I hope that the campground can really be the model for the many other groups here, the East Chop Association, something. the West Chop something. I don't know the name of these groups. But there are a whole bunch of communities that do come here and are very tight with each other, but need to be connected this way if we want to be taking care of this issue, which I think we all have an interest in. So, thank you very much all. First of all, are there any questions for any of these folks? They're all going to stay for a few minutes afterwards if you have individual questions. But any questions for anybody who is here? If not, could I have a round of applause for these wonderful people who took their time? They are really terrific. Thank you very much for coming. My wife and I will be back. We're renting one of the houses on Dukes County. We're right in the campground. We'll see you Illumination Night. Thank you all for coming today. Hope you enjoyed.